for he knew it was out of self-interest that they had handed Jesus over to him. When Pilate was sitting in the judge's seat, his wife sent him a message, and it said, "Don't have anything to do with that innocent man, for I have been suffering a great deal today in a dream because of him." But the chief priest and the elders persuaded the crowd to ask for Barabbas and to have Jesus executed. "Which of the two do you want me to release to you?" asked the governor. "Barabbas," they answered. "What then shall I do with Jesus, who is called the Messiah?" Pilate asked. They all said, "Crucify him." "Why? What crime has he committed?" asked Pilate. They shouted all the louder, "Crucify him." When Pilate saw that he was getting nowhere, and instead the uproar was starting, he took water and washed his hands in front of the crowd. "I am innocent of this man's blood," he said. "It is your responsibility." All the people answered, "His blood is on us and our children." Then he released Barabbas to them, but had Jesus flogged and handed him over to be crucified. I will be preaching to you under the sermon title, "The Rebel, the Riot, and the Redeemer. Which Jesus do you want?" See, verse 15 says, it was the governor's custom at the festival to release a prisoner chosen by the crowd. History does not give us the origin of this custom, but based on the relationship of the Jewish people and the Roman Empire, it suggests that this custom was created by the governor to appease the people and to gain favor in their sight. You see, the devil tries something like this of us Christians all the time. He knows that we will not just outright serve him. He knows that we know better and have pledged our allegiance to the true kingdom. So he tries to bribe us into coming over to his side. You see, he'll offer you that job that will provide you with all the money you need to survive, to pay your bills and your tithes. All you have to do is work the Saturday shift every other week. He'll send a beautiful young lady or a handsome young man your way, who is everything you have ever dreamed and prayed for. She's intelligent. He's strong. She's thick. He is honest. There is someone that you can take home to your mama. All you have to do to solidify that relationship is sleep with the person. And then they'll yours forever. And don't think that you're too saved to be tempted. The devil knows what you want. He knows what you need. And he will use those things to try to get you to slip up and join him. Remember, this is the same devil that tried to get a starving Jesus to doubt who he was by offering him some bread. Don't let the governor's customs fool you into forgetting whose kingdom you belong to. The passage goes on to say, they had a well-known prisoner whose name was Barabbas. So the crowd gathered and Pilate asked, "Who do you want me to release to you? Barabbas or Jesus, who is called the Messiah?" For he knew it was out of self-interest that they had handed Jesus over to him. There are three things that this passage calls me to point out about people. One, more is not always better. Two, they will switch up any moment. And three, they have their own interest in mind. You see, more people does not always lead to the best situation. Let's take a look at some crowds in the Bible. How many of you remember the story of Zacchaeus? You see, the Bible tells us all he wanted to do was see who Jesus was. But because he was short, he could not see over the crowd. Zacchaeus was what some would call vertically challenged. And there may be some people in our lives, or even us ourselves, who are spiritually vertically challenged. All Zacchaeus wanted to do was see who Jesus was, but the crowd could not show him that. You see, the crowd was not a reflection of the one who they surrounded. They were a reflection of themselves. Sometimes as Christians, we have this mob mentality, crowd-like atmosphere. atmosphere, and we block others from seeing who Jesus is. Instead of creating a barrier around Christ, forcing others to seek higher ground, which was the tree in Zacchaeus' case, we should clear a path to him so that they may have access. More people is not always better. Another thing about people is that they can switch up at any moment. The events in our passage take place around Thursday night to Friday morning. Just a few chapters before this one, we see that on Sunday, Jesus rode into town on a donkey in the city of Jerusalem, and the people were putting their clothes on the ground, spreading tree branches before him. Not only did they give Jesus the welcome of the king, if you look at the word Hosanna, you will find that it comes from a Hebrew word, Hoshiana, which translates to save us, please. Some of the same people that were in the crowd welcoming Jesus as the king and praising him as their savior were probably in that crowd that wanted to set Barabbas free instead of Jesus. We've all seen those people in our lives who smile in our faces, make us feel like we mean something to them, but then turn their backs on us. But it's okay, because that's not where the story ends. The Bible warned us about this, saying that as he is in the world, so are we. We will be hated, we will be criticized, and our character and motives and source of authority will be questioned. But don't lose hope, because Jesus went through the same things, and in the end, we will be overcomers. The third thing about people that we can learn from this passage is that sometimes they only have their own interest in mind. You see, the religious leaders of Jesus' time felt threatened by him. Jesus was handed over because he was a threat to the religious leaders. Jesus claimed to be Messiah, which means that his authority outweighed their authority. The deeds of Jesus also angered the religious leaders. He cast out demons, and they tried to attribute it to the work of the devil. Jesus was a threat to their religious system. He pointed out hypocrisy and that was connected with their practice. The religious leaders were filled with pride and arrogance. They were particularly proud that they did not associate with the sinners. They did not believe that the Messiah would be found with such people. They were holier than thou. Sounds familiar. Above all else, the lack of respect that Jesus had for their religious traditions, which they observed so minutely, angered them, because Jesus knew, that they were human-made rules that did not come from God. People only have their own interest in mind. Now let's get back to the passage. It says, "Which one of the two do you want me to release to you?" asked the governor. They said, "Give us Barabbas, give us Barabbas." He said, "What shall I do with the one you call Messiah?" They said, "Crucify him, crucify him, crucify him." Now, we have seen that the religious leaders want Jesus dead because he is a threat to them. He is a threat to their way of life, their false truth, and the alternate facts. The thing I couldn't understand is why the people wanted to free Barabbas. Who is this man, Barabbas, that they wanted him over an innocent man? Who is Barabbas? You see, that's when I did a little research, and it changed my perspective and opened my eyes to the situation. Mark 15, verse 7 says, "And there was one who was named Barabbas, who was chained with his fellow rebels, who committed murder in the rebellion." Luke 23, verse 18 and 19 says, "And they cried out at once, saying, Away with this man, and release to us Barabbas, who had been thrown into prison for a certain rebellion made in the city, and for murder." From these other gospel writers' descriptions of Barabbas, we can see that he was a rebel and was part of a certain rebellion. He was being tried for crimes against the Roman Empire. We also can tell that Barabbas was part of a rebellion against the Roman Empire because of the fact that he was up to be crucified. History tells us that crucifixion did not originate with the Jews and their judicial laws. Crucifixion was a brutal form of punishment that was common among the Romans. The Romans chose this form of capital punishment to put fear into everyone that would stand up against Rome and Roman laws. From this information, we get a better picture of who Barabbas really was. He was a rebel. He was a freedom fighter trying to bring an end to Roman subjugation. And perhaps in the eyes of some of the people in the crowd that day, in. He was a hero. Another thing that stood out to me, stay with me, was that his name Barabbas. You see, as I was looking deeper into the text, I noticed something that I had never seen before. Something that made me read the text multiple times to make sure I wasn't making a mistake. In the original language, Barabbas' name read, Iason ton Rabbon. All my Greek scholars out there know that Iason is the masculine singular accusative of the name Iesus, which translates to Jesus. This is where things really start to get interesting. You see, now we have two men being tried with essentially the same name. The only thing that distinguishes these two men is the eyes of their character. You see, the way that they are perceived by the people. On one hand, we have a man who claims to be the Son of God, sent to raise up a new kingdom, but all he does is heal the sick, give sight to the blind, give life to a dead man, cast out demons, allow a paralyzed man to walk again, feed over 5,000 with a small boy's lunch, and cause trouble for the religious leaders. But on the other hand, we have a man who is actively trying to bring an end to Roman subjugation, the torment of the Roman Empire. This man is fighting back. He is someone who the people have been looking for. You see, they have been under subjugation for generations. And perhaps it was so easy for the crowd to throw Christ under the bus because he didn't come in riding on a horse to conquer Rome. You see, he was too humble. He suffered too much. He ate with sinners. These were not things that they wanted their new king to do. How many of us would have been right there with them screaming Barabbas? My question to you today is, which Jesus do you want? Do you want the false salvation that the world offers that has nothing behind it to back it up? The devil is writing checks that he cannot cash. Stand to your feet if you want true salvation, which comes only from the Lamb that was slain to take away the sins of the world, and they will call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us. He is Alpha and Omega. He is the beginning and the end. He is the beloved Son of God. He is the Good Shepherd. He is the Lion of the tribe of Judah. He is the way, the truth, and the life. The people in Jesus' day wanted a conquering king, but hold up. Revelation 19 says, and I saw a heaven opened, and behold, a white horse, and the one seated on it was called Faithful and True, and with justice he judges and makes war. Now his eyes were like flame of fire, and on his head was royal headbands, having the name written that no one except himself knows. And he was dressed in an outer garment dipped in blood, and his name was called Word of God. And the armies of that are in heaven, dressed in clean, white, fine linen, were following him on white horses, and out of the mouth came sharp sword, so that he could strike the nations, and he would shepherd them with an iron rod, and he stumps out the winepress of the wine of the furious wrath of God, of all power. He has the name written on his outer garment and on his thigh, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. I asked you, which Jesus do you want? But there is only one Jesus Christ. Acts 4 verse 12 says, there is salvation in no one else. There is no other name under heaven that is given among the people by which you must be saved. The people were right when they said, his blood is on us and on our children. And if you want to be covered by that blood, all you have to do is ask him to be your Lord and Savior. You see, I know which Jesus I want, but to you, let us pray. Dear gracious Heavenly Father, we ask the question, which Jesus do we want? But Father God, we realize there is only one Jesus Christ. There is only one true Messiah. There is only one Son of the living God. Right now we pledge our allegiance to him, Father God. We ask you to come into our lives and to make us new, Lord. We realize that your blood is on us, Lord. And we accept that sacrifice, Lord. We accept you as our Lord and Savior today. Bless us, continue to sustain us, and hold us in your loving grace.